Hi, my name is Ron Perry, and you are watching the Old Bay District Build. This is a project that was funded by people just like you. Patrons fuel this channel with inspiration, and I then return the favor by building scale models and miniature terrain scenes in a fine scale way. Becoming a patron is as easy as chipping in $1, and no, this is no money grab. All funds are used to support the building of more fine-scale modeling videos in the future. In fact, because of our amazing patrons, we have our next project over 50% funded. And that is a great thing. For the rest of the summer, after this project, or maybe running concurrently with this project for a period of time, we're going to be building a carnival layout in the same 3x5 format. The carnival layout is going to focus heavily on scratch building while building around a few very rare and expensive models. And my intention is to show that even though you might spend a couple $100 on one model, but surrounding that model, you could have pennies worth of great design. Design doesn't have to be a huge hit on your credit card. Design can actually be scratch made from materials all over your house. Or maybe you can go to the dollar store or some other hardware store to get a product that is marketed in a different way, but is drastically cheaper than what you'll find in a hobby store. If you are entertained or informed in any way watching these videos, I ask that you either become a patron or check out our sponsor, Helicon Focus, at modelersguild.com/HF. And I want to thank you for watching this video. Due to some kindly shared feedback, we now have a supply list of glues and tools and things that I use on my models these days. If you've got some good advice, share it kindly. Nobody likes to have advice shared in a very critical way online. If you have critical feedback, share it privately. And that way you can have an honest and respectful conversation with the artist about their work. Critically evaluating their work online when you're not really even an expert is kind of silly. Hey cat, how are you doing? You started the video with the cat, so we're all good, right? Hopefully you'll recognize the fact that the recording light is on there, skinny. I'm going to start this video with a new trick that I've been working on, and about halfway through the video, we're going to see how, well, we're going to see how this is actually train wreck television, because what the effect that I accomplish with my airbrush on the roads is going to screw me up in other ways. And the place where I've put my desk doesn't have a ceiling fan right over top of it anymore. So I don't want to get ahead of myself, so we'll talk about that in a moment. Now, using my homemade thinner, I thinned out some slate gray paint, and that's kind of like a light gray. And all I want to do is color the sides, the embankments of my roads, so that there's some variation in the color, and there's a pattern. Like, I want to create a pattern on the road so that it looks like off to the side it's real mucky, or doesn't, you know, it's got some depth to the color, so that if I put stones on top of it or grass on top of it, it has a depth, it has a shadow. You know, in art, you really have to create your shadows, because you're not always going to have the sun there to help you out. So at first I'm using painter's tape to avoid overspray. And I'm kind of learning how to use the airbrush here. And the thing is that I'm not using the cap on top of my my airbrush, which it pushes the paint out a lot less and it gives me a lot more control. But this is only because I'm not hugely experienced on an airbrush, and I'm just kind of learning this for myself. There's a lot of mistakes that are gonna happen in these early days of me learning the airbrush, specifically overspray. And how the heck do we deal with it? Now, spraying the embankments with the slate gray was a great idea, in my opinion, because the overspray went over the grass and gave it the initial gray look. And when I come back later with my earth color, it's gonna go over top of it with like a tan dirt from the cars driving past on the road, and it's really working out great in my opinion. I love the effect. Now, once I got a feel for the airbrush and how it was gonna work with the consistency of the paint I added to it, because airbrushes, until you've learned how to mix paints properly for an airbrush, you're gonna be challenged time and time again. Well, I am challenged time and time again by mixing my paints. I don't go out and buy airbrush ready paints. I mostly use my dollar store paints and thin them out with my own homemade thinner. So I'm working behind the eight ball on this one, because these paints aren't the highest quality. Their pigments aren't the finest quality. And you know, sometimes they get thick and they jam up your brush like crazy. So after I've sprayed the embankments, I take off my painter's tape, so because I'm feeling a little bit more comfortable with the spread coming out of the brush. And I want to do the middle of the road. Now, this slate gray is combining with my limestone silt perfectly. Like the colors in real life, like not against the camera, look awesome. However, because my cap is off of my airbrush, I'm really just nicking the surface of this. Once I put the cap back on my airbrush, it acts in a very different way, pumping the paint right out. And because the plan works so well, everything's looking just the way I'm kind of planning it to look. And because of that, I'm just gonna put everything down and leave this as it is, because I could go too far with it, and sure, I could come back with more limestone silt, but I don't want to do that. I kind of want to be patient with this and have a real good game plan for the next time I touch the road. So let's move on to something else that I've been wanting to work on. And that is tea leaves for mimicking real leaves in HO scale. But I can't really take tea leaves right out of a tea bag now, can I? I kind of have to make a cup of tea, a cuppa, to be able to get the tea to run itself out so that it doesn't stain the layout when I add glue to it. Because, you know, I imagine that the second I add glue to this full strength tea leaves, it'll probably stain the whole layout. And I'm starting to think to myself now that might be a really cool idea for maybe like a rusted ground underneath some, you know, scrapyard or something. Huh. Well, there goes my mind. We'll be right back when I get back into shape. So we're going to use the tea bags for something else too, because I like the tea bags and I'm thinking they're going to be useful for something. I don't know just yet. I'm not going to really say it because I could just go off into dreamy land all over again. We don't want that to happen. So we're going to keep those bags to the side though, and then I'm going to let the tea grinds or whatever they are dry right out over about a week's period so that they're properly dried. However, off camera, during the whole airbrushing session, what I didn't really notice was how much paint was suspended in the air. And holy crap, I bet you it's everywhere. You see, like I said earlier, there's a fan over top of where the desk used to be. So I really didn't have this problem a couple of weeks ago when I pulled the airbrush back out. So we have to keep an eye on that. I obviously have to keep the door open while I'm doing that, or paint outside. Because old lens on the camera got all painted up, and much of the video that follows from here on in has a blurry camera. So I'm gonna have to come back and redo parts after the first segment in the tree, in this tree set. Words are getting hard. So I have a bag of Super Trees, the sagebrush version left over. I've got basically enough for two trees. It looks like I've got a whole bunch of it, but it really, these are really small chunks of branch, and you really need a bigger tree than that to work. So I'm gonna use my gel CA. Well, it's not really gel CA, it's kind of in between gel, and it's not classified as gel, but it's thick. It's not runny. And I really don't care if it turns white after a couple of days because I'm gonna paint over it. And that might be in next episode or the episode after that. So don't worry if you don't see that happening. It's gonna happen. Don't get your panties in a bunch. So, we're gonna glue these branches together. Now, a great idea to keep the trees together while they're gluing with the gel CA because it doesn't glue instantly. So, I'm gonna use these little clamps that I bought from the dollar store to keep them in place. And you don't really have to even clamp on the joint itself. You can clamp on each side of the joint and kind of make kickstands and stuff like that so it sits properly. Now, I've seen a number of people say that to use these super trees, you have to have a pin vise and you got to drill yourself a hole in the bottom of the tree and make yourself a nice little anchor to affix the tree to the layout. Well, every time I've ever tried to drill out one of these trees, it's a real rickety situation, for lack of a better word. Fact is every time I've tried to drill out that hole, it's either blasted out the side, split the wood in two in a very destructive way, or the piece of stick gets broken inside the hole, and everything has to start over from that point on. I glue my toothpicks to the outside of the tree. I have no problems hiding the toothpicks with paint, and it's a realistic look on the tree. It can be made to look realistic on the outside of the tree. It isn't necessary to drill these trunks out. Really, it isn't. You know, like, if you learn anything from my videos, it should be the fearlessness of mixing your own paint. Because, you know, once you start really getting the insight into how to mix and apply and layering paint, all this stuff ain't no thing. Now, this video was supposed to have a very large segment about gluing the sage tree trunks together. And you know what? We're gonna make more trees in the future. I'm gonna get more supplies and we'll do another tree journal entry someday down the road. Don't worry about it. So it's no big thing. So I'm just going to redo parts of the video that I had that I've cut out because you don't want to watch blurry video. Like, this ain't 1980s. I gotta keep my mouth shut again so I don't get myself in trouble. Old agencies. So, what I'm gonna do is I had the trees with all the super tree, the seafoam super tree substance material, and I already had it placed onto the tree armatures, and they were just placed there, and it was lucky because I need to glue them yet, and I noticed that the video was all derped up and all blurry, so I was able to take the super tree material off and spray the armatures with Kraft spray-on adhesive. Now, use gloves when you're doing this. this spray-on adhesive is... it's not fun when you get it all over the place. And it really does get all over the place. Like, realistically, you want to use this stuff outside because it goes everywhere and it makes everything really sticky, and it's not fun at all. However, I'm just going to spray the top of the tree armatures with the spray-on adhesive so that when I put my super tree, the seafoam stuff, on top of it, it'll get sticky. Hopefully it'll get sticky. And then when I come back, I'm going to spray the craft glue onto the seafoam. And I'm keeping my hands over top of the tree trunk with the gloves on so that I can avoid getting glue onto the trunk. Because the last step has me throwing ground foam and other materials all over it, and you don't want that stuff sticking to your trunk. It's going to look mucky. You're either going to have to spend a lot of time cleaning it up, or it's just going to look like crap because you left it on. Now, you may notice that each tree has a different color. The one tree I had sprayed with the same gray color that I sprayed on the road embankments. It was kind of the slate gray with a little bit of brown added to it. We're starting to mix the color. And the other tree had a plain earth tone to it, which is kind of like a reddish brown. Now, having these different colors on the inside of the tree will affect its look in the end. And you'll see that after the fact, because we're putting the same kind of leaves or leaf material on the trees, but each tree has a distinctive look after the fact. Now, I'm using Flockin' Turf from Scenic Express to put my basic foliage on these trees. Now, it's not my final go. I've already sprayed the tree with my craft glue, and now I'm going to add the foam, the Flockin' Turf, which is foam and static grasses. It's got a lot of textures and colors in it. It's a little bit darker, though, and I like the fact that it's darker because it adds shadow to the bottom of the tree. Sprinkle the Flockin' Turf on the tree liberally while trying to protect the trunk so you don't get any Flockin' Turf on that. Lightly shake the tree to get the excess off. The excess, you want to get the excess off because less is more when you're making these trees. You could have a tree that looks like a beach ball with a lollipop stick stuck in the bottom of it, but that's not really a tree in real life. That might be a tree out front of Donald Trump's house, but it's not a tree in real life. So my suggestion is less is more. You want to see sections of the trunk. That's why I'm protecting it. Now, my last step for these trees is to give it one more shot of craft glue, a light shot of craft glue. And then I'm going to put my trees down and sprinkle directly from the top. I'm just going to sprinkle the product called Super Leaf Material. Now, it looks just like leaves. And it's a really nice product, but I only have a sample package, so I'm going to make the most of it. And all I want to do is, my trees are kind of a dark green, and when you are looking at trees from above, like the helicopter view that we usually see when we're looking at a model railroad, What you get on top of these trees is the light from the sun, and underneath is a ton of shadow. So trees really have a very big tonal variation between the top and the bottom of the tree. So when I add this super leaf material right to the top of the tree, it gives you that full effect of the sun shining on the top of the tree, and the green on top of the tree is enhanced and brighter and more yellow. It's got realistic tones for you to look at. So even though you just took this beautiful super tree and pounded it with ground foam, putting this super leaf material on top really is the cherry on top of the sundae. I was gonna say cake. Cake doesn't really fit. I'm not really a cake eater anyways. Okay, my friends, that's the end of another video. Couple of questions for you. We had some classical music in this video. And what'd you think about that? I kinda like it. I listen to classical music often in the shop, in the background, and you can't really hear it. But I found out that it's all royalty, well, a lot of it is royalty free in the public domain, and we're free to use it in our videos. So, do you like this classical music? I really think it fits. It's kind of like the cartoon background of our youth. Whatever. If you like this episode, if you are entertained in any way watching these videos, please consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/Ron Perry. Patrons fuel this channel. They fuel my inspiration. Like, these patrons are actually obligating me to make more content. And if you like what you see with this channel, if you want to see this stuff just get pumped out and have layout after module after module after 3x, blah, 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 I'll do it, man. I'm right into it. I'm passionate about these things. And these patreon.com/Ron Perry feeds that passion in full. And hey, if you're not into that monthly thing, maybe you're into taking photos of your models. Maybe you're taking some tips from this channel and you're thinking to yourself, I want to make some real nice models and get in the magazines. Well, you'll get in the magazines before I do, that's for sure. And if you want to get your photos in the magazines, you should be using Helicon Focus. And I can get you 20% off a lifetime of updates to Helicon Focus. Just go on over to www.modelersguild.com/HF. I want to thank Helicon Focus for sponsoring this show. I want to thank you for watching this show. You know what? It feels really good to be doing a project that you feel good about, and people are watching it, and patrons are coming on each month. That's a real treat, let me tell you. So I just want to say thank you. Do you like the classical music? And happy Easter.